I call the Finance Committee meeting of the City Council to order for Monday evening, July 20th, 2015. Councilors, welcome back. It's been a few weeks. Appreciate you being here, and same to our guest. This time, I'd like to recognize Councilor Cruz.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Obviously, with summer schedule, we've been gone for a while, and it's no news in this past couple of weeks. The City of Brockton and my family personally has lost a great asset and a great friend and a great representative. And my cousin Tom Kennedy did so much for so many, and I'd like to ask you to take a moment of silence for the Senator.
Thank you, Council. Let me just say before you, Councilor, that his spirit will be felt in these council chambers for many, many years to come, as he started right over there where Councilor Azak sits.
Absolutely. We had to cut the ramp in when he got elected. But I'd further like to take a moment of personal privilege, and on behalf of the Kennedy Cruz extended family, thank everyone in this city, everyone in this chamber. The outpouring of support was magnificent. Anybody who hasn't been through something like that, I can tell you that the support really makes you feel wonderful. The stories of so many different people that Tom had done things for, many that we knew about and many that nobody ever knew about. And I'd particularly like to thank my fellow councilors, the school committee, Kathy Smith, who had the school children out lining the route of the motorcade to the church. The police and fire honor guards, particularly Archie Gormley and the fire honor guard, who have been such great friends to Tom through the years. And I just, on behalf of our family, I want to thank everyone in the city and everyone in this this city government, and thank you very much personally.
Thank you, Councilor. May he rest in peace. Councilors, just to indicate to you as well, this evening, Councilor Monahan is out of town, won't be here this evening, and Councilor Stewart is out of town as well, and he will not be present this evening. That being said, there is a resolve on here in regards to what Councilor Stewart wanted sent back to the Finance Committee meeting for this particular July meeting, and that was in regards to the staffing department within the police department. And if I didn't say it, but the Chief of Police will not be present as well. So I would rather, at this time, move that item, somebody make a motion, we postpone to the next...
Motion to postpone to the next Finance Committee meeting?
Second.
Yep. Motion been made and seconded, we postpone to the next Finance Committee meeting in August. All in favor? Opposed? We'll hear that one, in August. Councilors, the first item on our agenda, Madam Clerk, you can read it, and then I'll take it from that point.
Order that the City Council of the City of Brockton, acting pursuant to Chapter 40Q of the Massachusetts General Laws, hereby approves the Downtown Brockton District, designates the City of Brockton Planning and Economic Department, directs the City of Brockton Assessing Department, and authorizes the Planning Department to take any other action in connection with the approval of the district. Invited John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Robert May, Planning Director.
And councilors, that being said, with this particular item, through Mr. May's office, the planning office indicated to me that we have to have a public hearing. And as you know, we did advertise for the public hearing to be held this evening, July 20th at 7 p.m. As part of this meeting as well. So with that being said, with the first item, I'm going to open the meeting at the public hearing at this particular time, and I'm going to ask if there's anybody here in favor that wishes to be heard on this particular item, which is Chapter 40Q of the Massachusetts General Laws, hereby can come up and state their name to the clerk, and we'll take it from there. Good evening.
Good evening, Councillor, and through you to the other councillors. For the record, my name is Rob May. I am Director of Economic Development, Planning and Economic Development for the City of Brockton. And shortly after I started here in August of 2014, it's almost my anniversary, we reinvigorated a partnership with Brockton 21st Century Corporation and Trinity Financial, the developers of the Enterprise Block, to work on several projects together and to grow that cooperation into a much larger group. We applied for and have received designation as a Transformative Development Initiative District under Mass Development. And as a part of that partnership, we bring to you tonight a proposal to participate in the Massachusetts 40Q DIF program, District Infrastructure Financing Program. Basically, what this is about is a way to recapture some of the investment, some of the proceeds that are coming out of this community in the way of new taxes in this district, and then reinvesting them back into projects and programs that have been identified in a plan. Tonight's action is about establishing a base assessment level. Everything that is below that, that at and below that base continues to come into the general revenue fund of the city to be distributed by yourselves to projects as you see fit. Dollars above that, the new incremental growth that occurs will be segregated into a special account that will annually then come before you for disbursement in accordance to a plan that we are now in the process of developing with Mass Development and with our partners in the community that will eventually be approved by you. So I would like to introduce Angus Jennings, a consultant who has been before this body before and may have spoken with you earlier about the DIF process and why this is an important step for our community to take in order to facilitate development in our community.
Thank you. Good evening.
Thank you. Thanks very much to Rob, to the council, through you, the chair. And so my name is Angus Jennings. I'm a planning consultant. Part of my practice focuses on infrastructure finance. And as Rob said, 40Q DIF is it's really one of the main kind of tools in the toolbox that's available through Mass General Law. And just to reiterate or paraphrase what Rob said, once a district is created through the DIF legislation, it establishes the original assessed value, locks that in, and anything above and beyond that is subject to capture through the DIF to be allocated for purposes either that advance the DIF or to go back into the general fund. So the way the statute is organized, the process of creating a DIF district is both adoption of the district, which sets the bounds, and you can see before you the map, and I believe that's in your packet as well. So that would establish the bounds of the district, would lock in that original assessed value as of the most recent assessment, which was January of this year, and then the second step associated with approval of a DIF is the adoption of a program or a budget. That is not before you tonight. That's something that will be developed or is in the process of being developed as part of a broader plan for the downtown Brockton. So any allocation of funding through the DIF would be subject to the budgeting approval of this body and would be brought before you not piecemeal, but in the context of an overall budget that prioritizes actions based, you know, infrastructure, that sort of thing. So so it's you know, it's fairly, it can be fairly arcane concept, but it's you know, we've tried to present it as clearly as possible. Happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Okay, very good. Anything else, Mr. Mabee? I just want to continue with the hearing, then we'll get into further discussion with councilors at that point in time. So is there anyone else here that would like to be heard in regards to this particular item in favor of? I'd ask them to come up and state their name to the clerk. Anyone else? Would like to? Yes, sir. Just come right up front and state your name to the clerk.
Good evening. I'm Michael Gallerani, from the Executive Director of Brockton 21st Century Corporation. And as Rob said, we're a partner in this process. We look forward to being able to do some outstanding things, and of course we support what is before you this evening. The DIF is just a major step in the right direction for what we have planned to do with downtown and the rest of the city. So on behalf of B21's Board of Directors, I'll state their support. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you. Anyone else that wishes to be heard in favor of, please come forward, state your name to the clerk as well.
Hi, my name is Fran DeCoste. I'm a resident of Brockton, 56 Darren Drive.
Yes.
I'm also a real estate developer and advisor. And when I heard about this proposed DIF, I was very excited. I've worked for the city of Chicago. They have similar types of financing to get infrastructure and development done. It's very successful, and as a resident here, I highly encourage your support. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you. Anyone else present that wants to be heard in favor of? Come to the clerk. Thank you, John.
Good evening. My name is John Marion. I am president of the 21st Century Corporation, president of Downtown Brockton Association, and I am a landowner, business owner in downtown Brockton. I'm here to support this initiative because I think that there is a lot of thought that has been brought forward. Rob and the team, the economic team, has worked out many different proposals, worked with the state. We're working with the state right now, of course, on many different projects. And I think it's imperative that we show strength with regard to anything that's available to us locally and or partnering with the state, as it's important that they look at us and see that we're serious about our plan that we're putting forward. I also want you to consider this in a way of which we've had challenges in downtown with regard to any type of infrastructure or any type of investments that we've come across. One of them is parking. That's going to be a challenge. Where does the money come from? I think this is a creative way to look at initiatives to see if we can finance and move forward with some of these projects, whether they be little at the beginning or if momentum comes in and there's a tremendous amount of investment, of which there is now, $180 million worth. And if more continues, we can use some of that money incrementally to go into some of these other projects that we're going to need. So hopefully you'll give us your support, and thank you very much.
Thank you, John. Anyone else here who wishes to be heard in favor of this particular item? Seeing none, I'm going to declare that part of the hearing closed. Is there anybody here that's in opposition to what we're trying to do here this evening? Anyone who wants to be heard in opposition, please come forward and state your name to the clerk. Hi, how are you?
Hi, good evening. I'm Jean Holmes. I live at Belcher Ave. I'm not entirely against this, but I have some grave concerns. As I understand this process, and I think it's important for taxpayers to understand this, everything looks gold when it's shiny, but what happens when the gold wears off? In this particular process, as I understand it, and I am not an expert on this, so I appreciate any clarifications that I can receive, but I understand that this process involves the city borrowing money against future taxes under the DIF program, and that those future taxes would be generated from the activities within the DIF district. I am confused when I look at that map about the district as it's currently proposed. I would like an explanation on why it is that this particular district, downtown area, doesn't really just have the downtown area in front of it, but actually it includes a substantial amount of area that is north of downtown, and it doesn't equally recognize those who are on the southern side of the downtown area. I have grave concerns about that. I don't think that that's fair. The way that the district is set out, and I respectfully would suggest that this committee give careful consideration to that. It's not good to be exclusive, and this map looks exclusive to me. I have concerns about the city borrowing money. Obviously, it's important for us to do something, and I understand that it takes money to do things, but we need to be careful. We know, many of us in this room know, that the city of Brockton has taken risks, and there are risks with this DIF program, recognized risks that could substantially harm the city. Now, if all goes well, and the developers come in, and they pay us everything that we're supposed to get, and we get funds, that would be wonderful. But I have to honestly say, I'm optimistic that that can happen here in Brockton, and I have seen where the DIF has worked in other cities. I've seen downtown Worcester, I've seen Somerville, I've seen the areas where it has worked. But sometimes Brockton doesn't have the best luck. And I have to say that some degree of luck is involved in this proposal. And what concerns me is, what is our backup plan? I mean, I could support this plan wholeheartedly if I knew and heard that there was a backup plan, but I'm not sure that there is a backup plan. What do we do when the developer doesn't do what they say they're going to do, when the downtown doesn't get revitalized, when those future taxes that we are hoping for, and they are a hope, they're a wish and a prayer, but they're not reality, what happens when those particular funds aren't available and we're left with yet another burden to the taxpayers? Because that's what will happen, as I understand it, with the DIF. If it falls apart, then the taxpayers are going to be on the hook again. We've been on the hook again and again with these types of projects. So I'm not saying that we shouldn't do it, but I'm thinking that we need to really start making sure that we protect the city's interests when we're taking this type of risk on. As I understand it, a risk would be if the inadequate tax base is created, the city is on the hook to pay the money back for the improvements. That's going to come off of the back of the taxpayers. And it's important for the taxpayers to know that, yes, if this is successful, there will be money, but it's only going to be for downtown. It's not going to help anybody out on West Elm Extension. Okay, so that also needs to really be very clear to the taxpayers. And I'm sure that you all are aware of this, and what I'm saying is probably things that you've already considered, and I look forward to hearing what it is that you all have discussed in regards to this. And I look forward to the hearing the backup plan. But if we don't have a backup plan, we are really taking huge risk here. If there's an inadequate tax base created, then the rest of the Brockton is going to have to pay for the city services that are consumed by the DIF. So, I mean, I would caution you in regards to this. I have to say that, you know, I think that one of the ways, obviously, to do that is to make sure you have a mitigation agreement with these developers that puts it on them. Make them the responsible parties, not the city of Brockton. That is the best way for us to protect ourselves and to make something good. It's in their best interest to make it good, but it may not happen. And what happens if the developer comes in and develops wonderfully and then nonprofits come in? What happens to that future tax base that we're expecting? These are the things that need to be talked about and protected against. I haven't reviewed the whole plan. I haven't seen it. I don't even know if there is a plan with these information in here. But I urge you and beg you to please be cautious and be careful. This is wonderful to revitalize. And I don't oppose the revitalization of downtown Brockton. I do oppose doing it in a way that the city will ultimately not be a benefactor, but actually will be yet another victim.
Thank you. Very good. Thank you. Any of your comments will be taken under advisement. I'm sure there'll be further discussion in regards to some of the things you've raised. Anyone else here that's like to be heard in opposition to? Please come forward and state your name to the clerk.
Ann Beauregard, Anawan Street. It's, again, I'm not in opposition, but what I'd like to see is a little bit more research be available to us. Who are these companies and what do they plan on doing? Are they large employers? Are they going to benefit the citizens of this city? Also, like the one individual in front of me that just mentioned, that the way you look at the map, it includes downtown, which is great. I'm downtown 5 and 6 days a week. I know what's happening downtown and what I want to see happen. But also, there are other areas of the community that seem to be, how do I say, experience a small downfall. And for those of us that live on the east side, there's an east side plaza that's relatively empty. And there are also other buildings where we've had a restaurant that's no longer there and it's empty for several years. And these are, I'd like to see more feasibility studies done on what we anticipate, who's going to need this, what does their financial background appear to be, what do they contribute to a community in another area, whether it's another part of the country, another part of the state. Having seen the success in Worcester, and seeing in several other, you know, towns, Chicago, I've been there, that they have the Miracle Mile. Again, that's a large city. It gets a great deal of attention. We are a city, but we're not quite as large as Chicago, and we're not quite as large as Worcester. But it seems that the more that we understand what's being invested, why, and where the conclusion came with the study on such an item or such a building or such how would I say, a project. I think that would be important for everyone to understand and be aware of, and I ask you to really consider that when you're making decisions. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you. Is there anyone else here that wants to be heard in opposition to this particular item? Seeing none, I'll declare that part of the hearing closed, and I declare the hearing closed at this time. I do want to mention, when I had conversation with the mayor last week, he did want to attend to speak on behalf of this as well, but this evening he's in Boston attending a conference with other mayors in regards to CDBG funding to make sure we're secure for funding for this year, and he wanted to make sure that he was there because we cannot lose that funding. So that's where he is this evening and unable to attend. At this point in time, we can take some questions or... Yeah, why don't we take questions? Councilor Cruz, yeah, we'll go.
Thank you. I think probably, okay. Rob, if you could come up first. Ms. Holmes has a lot of the questions that I have already written, too. This is an idea that we've talked about, and I think it's a good idea, but I do have some questions. My first question is, this is not a downtown increment, this map. I mean, that certainly stretches way to the north of downtown. That goes all the way up, if I'm reading the map right, to Cary Hill, correct?
No, sir. It does include the area that is around the post office, and what you see that's sticking out to this edge, if I may, part of this area are the CSX rail yards that are currently abandoned and should be a redevelopment opportunity within the city. And that is one of the reasons why we're proposing such a large downtown DIF area. The infrastructure improvements that need to be made to that area, including environmental remediation, new roads, new water and sewer lines, all are going to require financial assistance above and beyond what the state or a private developer can invest in that area. If I could address one thing tonight, or one thing right off the bat, is that what we are doing tonight is asking the council to establish the base assessment value. We are not asking the city to take out any loans or even identify how we're going to spend this money. That is a plan that we are going to be developing that we have with Mass Development. As our partner, you may have seen an ad in the Enterprise just recently where myself and Mass Development, we were joined by Representative Brady and several other local community leaders in a walkthrough downtown to look at several development sites. This is the partnership that we have and are moving forward on that. So I'll end that answer there.
Okay, so that's not Cary Street at the top. That's comes right down by the cemetery then.
Elliott Street.
That's Elliott Street at the top.
Elliott Street is on the north.
Okay. Okay, that large area is the...
Is the CSX yards.
Which they've looked for... Which they've actually asked for an unbelievable amount of money in the past for that property. Right there. Okay. So the order tonight, if we were to pass it and pass it at the next meeting, strictly, what happens after that? Now, who gets to decide where the money is spent, and does that have to come back to this council before any money is spent?
Who decides where the money is spent? It's you.
So by establishing a district, we are not approving any.
Correct.
And we're not giving you the authority. I'm sorry to interrupt. We're not giving you the authority down the road to do this without coming back to us.
That is correct. What we're doing is establishing a base value. Any dollar that is above that base value gets put into a separate city account. Each year we'll have to come forward. Well, first of all, we will have to produce a plan, and we'll be working with the council and the councilors and several organizations in the city to develop this plan. We will be back this fall, early spring at the latest, with a plan for you to adopt. At that point, each year we will have to come forward to you for an allocation in the budget process every year. Now, the reason why we are doing this now is that by establishing the base, we can capture some of the incremental value that's being generated out of, say, the Trinity block, or out of the Trinity Financial investment, or on a project that's across the street at 121 Main, which is under review right now and will be coming forward to the planning board shortly. But by setting that limit, it goes back to January of this current fiscal year. So when the plan finally is adopted in 2016, we will actually have some money for you to work with to direct us on infrastructure projects, whether that's working on the downtown two-way transportation plan, whether that's facade improvements, site acquisition, brownfield remediation. These monies can be used as matching dollars for other federal and state grants that we need to come up with. But it's creating this plan that will come back to you is the next important part.
And once this plan is developed, are we locked into what's in the plan, or is the plan a blueprint?
The plan is... can be amended throughout its life. There is a certain... the plans used to have to go to the Economic Development Coordinating Council, EACC, by the state and be approved by the state. They do not anymore. It's approval by the city council. So in year five of the plan, if we're not doing something that's really working out, the council can direct us to update the plan and make amendments to it as they see fit.
Well, let's say we're even in the second year of the plan, and somebody comes in that says, I'll buy the CSX property if you put in this and, you know, put in the water and sewer. Can we amend it that quickly? Is there a time frame on when we can amend it?
Let me ask Angus, if I may ask.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, just
mention.
It would just go through the same public hearing process to amend, which would...
because I would think that whatever plan we make could change, the opportunities could change anytime.
Opportunities can change anytime. The plan needs to be flexible enough. It will establish generally line item accounts. So it'll, you know, road infrastructure, sewer utilities, water utilities. It might not name those directly that it's the sewer at Main and West Elm, but it'll keep broad categories, at which time we'll come back to the council at the beginning of the fiscal year and say, here's how we would like to spend what money is in that account.
And again, I'm asking some questions that I am in favor of this, but also there's some real questions about how we do this, and I agree with Ms. Holmes. As we get into the last item, agenda item tonight, we've gotten ourselves locked into some things in the past that we find out later didn't work as well as we thought they would.
Yeah, we bought the monorail.
My next question actually is probably for Mr. Condon. If Jay could come up and... thank you. So if we were to accept this and we get this pool of money, and again, it's say $400,000 supports a loan of X amount of dollars. Is it directly the city that's borrowing that money?
Well, there isn't any proposal at the moment which would have...
No, but if we accept it, I'm carrying it out. So we accept this, and then we have some money in this DIF. We have in the explanation, it talks about in the first year probably $319,000, right, which would support a loan of $3.9 million or something like that. Who's actually borrowing that money? The city of Brockton?
It could be the city of Brockton, yes. It could be.
Could be, or could be...
Well, I think it all depends, Councilor, on what each project says. It's a possibility to use the... if you borrow money and you're using this tax increment revenue growth to help pay for it, the obligation is still the city's, as was mentioned a few minutes ago,
right,
whether that increment comes through or not. It's the city's obligation to pay the bonds. So I don't know whether we'll be going to be doing any borrowing. Could be just direct appropriation of the cash. You could ask a developer to do the borrowing and secure the city's borrowing, as opposed to having the city's tax pledge secure. There are a number of different ways it could be done, but none of it can be done unless we come back to the city council for approval.
And how, and I guess, again, I'm moving down beyond what we're asking tonight, but how, if it's city tax dollars, how could we have the developer borrow the money? We can't give him the money.
No, but you could be obtaining from them a pledge to repay the cost. The city's obligation is still the city's obligation. You know,
so the bottom line is, if the tax, the assessments here,
yeah,
through the years it goes down to here, the city would be on the...
He's on the hook.
On the hook for it.
That's right.
But you're saying in some cases we could just use the, instead of borrowing, we could just use that amount of money if it would, if it was enough to pay for something.
Yes. Yes, I mean, it can be appropriated directly as opposed to being a source of...
A source of a loan.
Money. I mean, obviously, if you're using revenues which are going to be available for 20 years into the future, you can, you know, can capitalize it and issue a bond at the beginning of all of that, which is going to accomplish more for you if you're confident. My biggest suggestion with all of this is it has to be a very phased approach, step by step, carefully examined. Careful with respect to how large the projects are, what the specific projects are, careful as to who we ask to participate in terms of development and what kinds of agreements we have with those developers to secure their commitment to do what they say they're going to do. I don't think we should be going too fast on any of this. Very careful.
Right.
But I also think, Councillor, it's hard to envision a city like Brockton. We don't have a lot of tools to attract development
right.
into our downtown.
Right.
So I think we have to look at any tool which might help us to create the growth that we think we need.
Right. Thank you, Jay. And I just want to make sure, under the state law, that we'd be accepting, and I understand the reason to do it now is we want to do it before we get our first tax bill on Trinity, because otherwise the base is up here instead of down here.
Right.
I guess my only other concern is that we're committing dollars down here, and I represent Ward 1, up, you know, so we're not in the district, but anything that happens downtown helps all of us. We can clean up. The better we can make the center of the city, the better we all are. Although the other thing is that CDGB monies for infrastructure can almost only be used in pretty much the same areas, correctly? Correct?
Correct.
So, you know, infrastructure improvements in the outlying areas is really difficult to come up with any money. You know, this is kind of doubling up on the downtown. Because, as I say, CDGB is delineated by mostly by income neighborhoods that are pretty much an overlay to this, correct?
CDBG has a much larger, it extends from Campello through Montello, so there's a much larger area in which those funds could be spent. However, CDBG is dropping each year as we go along. And right now, the other component to CDBG, which is home, which comes from HUD also, used to have a $1.1 billion line item to be spread across the country. In the Senate version of the bill, there's $61 million.
Well, that's not good.
What that's going to do is really draw CDBG resources into other areas that need to be, that are usually carried out by HUD, which is low and moderate income housing. I want to point out a couple of things that this, you know, basically we're looking at downtown as a pilot area. If you remember, we were able to take the 40R in dividend that the state has paid to us and reinvest that back into the community. Some of that is paying for this. Half of the project is being paid for by Mass Development as we develop the plan. So we're leveraging state dollars there. But we also have funding to do work in the Campello neighborhood. That's our second strategy area. We will be creating a master plan down there. The second phase of that will also look at DIF and other development tools that we have there. We want to be working in Montello shortly after that. I apologize, but we're only a two-man shop. So we're kind of stretched thin. But we'll be publishing a map in the next couple of weeks that shows all the different development areas, and there's probably 10 or 11 that we need to do master plans for, and that includes the Crescent and Quincy corridors. There's a north and south side to that really needs to be reinvested in, as well as downtown and other areas of the city. So I don't want people to think that we're not thinking about those communities, because we are.
Well, actually, the other place we need to start looking at is the real retail center of the city, which is the Belmont Street corridor, which doesn't have any real planning right now, and we need to as we move forward. But so if I support this tonight, we're just making the baseline, we're accepting the idea of it, but nothing can happen until each time you have to come back to us, correct?
That is correct, sir.
Thank you.
If I could, you had asked a question about financing and bond financing, and I think that Angus has a comment to make on I'm sorry, I forgot all the state programs, but there's a state law that allows you to use the property as collateral from the developer. So if you could, which takes the city's risk away.
Yeah, and I'll keep this very brief, but in response to the earlier comment from the floor and also to your question, Councillor, the DIF legislation was adopted in 2003. In 2010, the legislature adopted a different statute called Chapter 23L, which is called the Local Infrastructure Development Program. That statute was specifically designed to work with DIF. It actually references DIF in the statute. And what it does, DIF, before Chapter 23L was enacted, a community had an option to do a general obligation bond, which, as you know, commits the full faith and credit of the city. With 23L, that gives you an additional tool. So if bonding, if debt service was put on the table, you would have the option to implement 23L, which would backstop the city's obligation through encumbrances placed on properties in the DIF district. So if, for instance, at some point in the future, a proposal was brought forward to issue debt service for infrastructure, if that debt service was issued on the expectation of certain private sector investments taking place and generating certain amounts of revenue, the city, through the 23L option, would have the ability to secure those future payments through an attachment and encumbrance upon those properties so that the landowner or developer would be on the hook for those payments whether the development went forward or not. So that's something that, as part of the broader planning process that Rob mentioned, that's something that has been part of the discussions with Mass Development.
And where would those encumbrances stand in the queue? I mean, is it a tax encumbrance?
Yes.
So it would be the first, you know, if he defaulted, it would be the first.
Actually, I'm not certain about that. It would be, it's secured by the land. But in terms of the order of priority, that's...
I mean, that would be, if you could get that information, because that would be, I mean, if it's not essentially a tax lien, if you're the fifth guy in line and he goes down south, doesn't matter if you're fifth or 50th, right, because you're not going to get that right money. So if you could find out that information for me.
Yeah, certainly before any, you know, in the event that any future debt proposal was brought before this council, all of those questions would be answered.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Barnes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Actually, a lot of my questions have been answered, but I just wanted to clarify something. Ms. Holmes actually brought up something when I met with you, Mr. Jennings, that day about if there were restrictions or how, I guess, heavy or how tight the restrictions are on spending whatever funds come in from this program. And I specifically asked about the Campello area, and if I remember correctly, it was a while ago, but if I remember correctly, you did say that some of the revenue that comes in, if we were to adopt this and set the plan, that would be in the best interest of the city, that we could use some of that funding for that area. Is that correct?
The answer is yes. That's not what's before you right now, because what's proposed is the single district.
Right.
But there's two parts of my response. One is that while 100% of the dollars above the base revenue is subject to capture, that doesn't mean it all needs to be captured.
Right, you did
say
that.
So the council could set a capture percentage less than 100%, and anything that's within the DIF district that's not captured for the DIF would go into the general fund and
right,
would be eligible for use anywhere in the city. And then the second part, which you correctly pointed out, is that the area of investment does not need to be coterminous with the district.
Okay.
As it's proposed before you, it is, but that could be modified you know, either prior to approval or in the future to allow for investment in other locations.
Okay, and just one, thank you very much, and just one thing that Councilor Cruz brought up about, and actually what you said about the L, the 23L program, that can be written into the fluid plan, right, going forward, that we could kind of modify that and have that in there, and any potential developers, they would know that that was something that they would...
But that's an option, yes, ma'am.
Okay, okay. I just had a question about one of the packets, just, I guess just for clarification. A lot of these addresses on here, some of them are like 00. Is that just a plot of land? Is it unbuildable? What does that mean? Or is that the address of that particular...
Generally, it's a property that has not been given an address through our assessing department. Sometimes these are... There's two lots that are adjacent to each other.
Mm-hmm.
For example, up on Oak Street, I own two lots. One is my address. The other is 0 Oak Street because it's behind me. So... that's why you see zeros in there.
Okay.
Some of them could be also undeveloped, and so because they haven't applied for a building permit, the engineering department hasn't given it a street address.
Okay. All right. Let me look. That's it. Thank you. Thank you,
You're
Mr.
Welcome,
Chairman.
Councilor. Councilor DiNapoli.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Is Mr. Conning still here? Jay, can I ask you a question?
He's in the room.
Is he in with the...
Attorney Gilday.
All right, okay. This question is for Mr. Conn, and I'm sure the Rob can't answer the question because it's on taxes. Good evening, Mr. Conn. I'm sorry I disturbed you at your meeting.
Counselor?
I have a question, okay? Yep. Now, this proposal is for quote-unquote new growth.
Right.
Okay. Now... I have a problem with the new growth because it doesn't go into the general fund. And we have businesses downtown that are paying a lot of money for taxes, and we have residents that are paying some high taxes. Can we, as a city, afford to do something like this where we're asking to take a percentage of the new growth? How much new growth is involved here?
I don't know.
Nobody knows.
That's right.
Right now, right?
Right.
So we're just grasping for straws.
That's right.
We're guessing, but we want to make an incentive to bring other companies to the downtown area.
Well, the purpose of setting aside the what's called the increment, the increase in taxes because of investment in the community. It's not a the purpose of it is to provide money to assist in enabling projects, not to do the project, but to enable the project if there's needed infrastructure, if there's a need to acquire a facility with city's eminent domain powers. That's what the purpose of it is. None of that money can be spent, regardless of whether you get a lot of new growth or not very much. None of that money can be spent without coming back to the city council. And even if you create this district, I believe that even though that money gets dedicated to this special account, it doesn't need to be spent in that fashion. If the city council determines and the mayor determines to put an appropriation to do something else with it, I believe it's still available for whatever lawful spending purpose the city council wants to use it for. So my other reaction to it is, as I said earlier, I think you've got to be very, very careful at the rate at which you proceed once you get into the project phase. But we're not there yet. We're just really establishing a district. If the city council feels the district needs modification in terms of its geography, you know, I think that's up to you. And you don't even have a plan in front of you yet as to how we intend to go ahead with this. I don't have a problem with the city council creating the district and awaiting the plan.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, I'm glad you brought that up, modification, because I see some problems here. Just, I know you probably went, you didn't do this.
No, this
sure.
Isn't my plan. No.
Okay, Jay, thank you, and I'll speak to Rob.
Okay.
Because he designed. Thank you very much, Jay. You answered my question, I hope. But good evening, Rob.
Good evening, sir.
Now, let me ask you a question on how you defined, well, let's take the area of Court Street, because it's my district, okay? You have an area that, there used to be a factory here. Okay, and it's no longer a factory. It's, if you go in back of the telephone company building, it used to be Air America, I believe. Okay, and you have it defined in here as a district. It's a church now. I'm sure you don't want to put that church in this district.
It's behind Court Street?
Yes.
204, actually, it's on the list.
It's behind Shayna Barnes's house.
Oh, yes, sir.
Okay. It is an old factory that was down there, and that now it's a church. I guess you didn't know that.
Well, I do know that there's a church. There's several churches in the district.
Well, no, I understand that, but why you don't have to define it to include that land, because I'm sure the church is not going anywhere. I was just wondering how you define that particular area. The only building on that street is the telephone company building. There's nothing else there, Rob.
Right. So, if I can try to do this upside down. The area you're talking about is over here next to the CSX yards. If I'm reading this correctly, it's directly adjacent to Trout Brook, which cuts through the property and then past the telephone exchange, and continues by.
Now, did you
in setting the boundaries?
Yeah.
We tried to create an area that had a large enough expanse of existing commercial and industrial development opportunities. In the CSX property, it is true that there is a church there, there's a church elsewhere. They will not be necessarily paying income tax, property tax into the city. So we're not going to capture anything. But it, rather than having a map that looks like a group of Swiss cheese, where we've chopped individual properties out, this is a much cleaner boundary for us to get our heads around. Why we've included this area that's behind the church, we do have an industrial property that's adjacent to it that is in desperate need of expansion. And
is that Evans Machine?
Yes, it is.
Okay,
we need to be able to look at the properties adjacent to it, which may or may not have some environmental concerns that we need to deal with, either through pollution or through wetlands and flood retention. So that's why we have that area south of the brook in the plains.
Okay, but you didn't go as far as Manchester Street, because Evans Manufacturing Company is on Evans Street. I know what you did. Okay, all right, that's fine. But, you know, some of the other questions were asked. Why didn't we go further south into Campello?
Why didn't we go into Campello? The question really is, why haven't we gone into Campello yet? It is on our target. We will begin a planning process for that district. We will probably consider coming back to you to create a DIF district for Campello specifically to capture investment in that neighborhood. So if we get too big, it's no longer a pilot and it can become unmanageable. And I guess when you look at it, it's a district investment fund. It's a district improvement fund.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're trying to keep to very specific districts as we do this. So downtown, and we've included the CSX property because when that gets developed, it will provide a significant stream of money into the district that will help us assemble sites elsewhere, to do brownfield remediation, improve the water quality along the Salisbury and Trout Brooks, identify new park space, but more importantly, and most importantly, is provide the infrastructure and the utilities that new businesses are going to need and new development is going to need downtown.
Okay. All right. Very good. As long as we do not leave Campello out of the realm.
Oh, we have
I
not,
I think
sir.
It's important. I know we can't go further north. But it looks good. I mean, I looked at this over the weekend, and I don't have any problem with it. You defined it pretty well. Okay, thank you, sir. Rob. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. Any other councilors before I go back? Councilor Sullivan, I'm sorry.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Mr. May.
Good evening, sir.
How are you tonight?
Very good.
First of all, I want to thank you guys for coming before us. And Mr. Jennings, in a prior life when I was on the planning board 12 years ago, I worked with Angus, and he's top-notch, so it's good to see him again. In terms of some of the issues that Attorney Holmes brought up and my colleague from Ward 5, could you explain some of the carve-outs? Like, there's a little V section on Pleasant Street, and there's a little hook down on Court Street. I'm just trying to figure out, first of all, what falls within that area?
Get back to the microphone. The little V that you see at Pleasant Street is where you come up with Ward and across to Spring Street. This is an important intersection. It's a gateway into the community. We have wonderful new development over here at the Vicente's Market. We need to work to create incentives for those three other corners. If you've been to the intersection, so you know that they need a lot of work. One of them is a vacant building, vacant lot. One is a multi mixed use building that could use some new investment opportunity. And there's a small strip mall on the actual V part. Again, these are gateways into the community and need investment opportunity.
Now, Rob, when this legislative body adopted 40R smart growth zoning, we worked pretty tirelessly with the former planner at that time. Is that V section, because I know the old Star Market, which is now the beautiful Vicente's, was specifically included in 40R. Was that area that we're talking about right now, is that also, or was it stopped?
Because
we had five sectors in Brockton.
This area within the V was not and is not in our current zoning ordinance as a 40R. However, it is in the proposed amendment to the zoning ordinance, and it's a new sub-district that we're calling Perkins Park.
Okay.
And it extends from Main Street into that V. And then we're proposing to expand the downtown core up to Linden Street.
Okay. In terms of that little section on Court Street, I call it the drop-down section. It's right there on the right. Yeah. What is that little drop-down section? Is that where the funeral home is on Court Street?
Mm-hmm. No, that is... That is all industrial property that drops down from around the church and the mechanic shop down onto Court.
Okay. All right. Now, it was mentioned tonight that the city of Somerville has adopted this. Brockton being a gateway city, how many other gateway cities have adopted this program? And then also, in your prior life in Somerville, did you see the true benefit of this?
I'll have to ask Angus how many gateways. I know Springfield and Worcester have diffs. I'm not sure who else does. In Somerville, we use this at the Assembly Square project.
Okay.
And at one time, the real estate value of the land was so high that the developer was going to self-finance. Unfortunately, 2008 happened, the bottom fell out of the real estate market, and the project was really on the rocks. It was hard to develop speculative development and to finance speculative development. And so formerly Somerville, entered into a development agreement with Federal Realty Investment Trust in which the city would finance or buy back certain infrastructure improvements. So they front-funded those activities. We then bought them back. So the major Assembly Square Drive was financed through the DIF. Local infrastructure, the small streets that are separating those new retail buildings and the Partners Health office building paid for that, as is the new stormwater outfall that connects all this, the stormwater management system from Assembly Square through Draw 7 Park and out to the Mystic River. So that was all paid for by DIF funds. And what that did was put money back into the developer's pocket to actually build the first three buildings. And so those weren't going to happen unless the city stepped forward and was able to shift funds in that way. And so the investment that Federal Realty paid for is then paying back the city, who's paying on the bonds to, you know, the bondholders.
Okay, okay. I mean, I think I concur with Mr. Conant. I think this is just the first step, and we have to take it slow. But also, I think what we've seen by 40R, it's a catalyst for investment. And I do concur with some of the statements that were made tonight. I mean, we need to, of course, work on downtown, continue to work on town, and also go south. And also, my colleague from Ward 1, my counselor, has mentioned Belmont Street. Many people call that the new Main Street. So I think we need to look into that. In terms of the actual nonprofits, we talked about churches. When this proposed district was generated, was there any type of analysis or any type of vetting out or looking at how many nonprofits currently exist in that district? Because I think from a tax recapture, we need to look at that.
We did do an analysis of the current assessment and the current tax bill of each of the properties, and I'll let Angus explain a little bit about that, but I don't think we actually quantified how many. We didn't tabulate that, but there is information that we have that we can find that.
That's right. As you see from the language in the order, part of what this order would do would direct the assessing department to establish the original assessed value. In fact, we've already established that using their data. They have to, legally, they have to do it and certify those values. But part of the analysis was to look at each parcel, what the original assessed value is as of this calendar year, and what the current taxes are. Because if the district was to be created, that's what would set the baseline. We did not look at projecting hypothetical development scenarios. We did look in detail at two developments that are already going forward, the Enterprise Block and the 121 Main, in terms of estimating what the potential revenues from those two developments would be, really more for the purpose of, you know, giving a sense of orders of magnitude of what kind of revenues are we talking about here. We did not undertake a district-wide projection of where there might be redevelopment, what that might generate in terms of revenues. You're correct to point out if something is a nonprofit use or, let's say, a city-owned parcel that currently is generating zero real estate taxes, if such a parcel were to change ownership and be redeveloped, that would represent a much bigger increment than a private, you know, something that's currently taxed and then is taxed at a higher you know, higher value.
Thank you. And Angus, in terms of your memo, you talked about, of course, the urban renewal plan, and your suggestion was to integrate the two initiatives. And I was just, I think that that's brilliant. I just want to know, Rob, your thoughts on that as well, number one. And the other, my last question would be relative to if there's any drawback for development relative to if a developer, of course, can qualify for TIF locally, and also historic tax credits. Is there any downside from a development? I know about the potential financial downside on the city, but is there also any type of negative that you're aware of right now for any future developers coming to Brockton that may reside within the DIF?
Any downside would be that any future project coming online, we would not want to necessarily consider using TIF financing for, because you're taking money out of the general investment fund and putting it into a single investor to pay for improvements on their property. So what DIF does is kind of shares that wealth district-wide, and it would not preclude us, but from a financial standpoint, it kind of, you're taking money out of one pocket and putting it in the other. So we generally wouldn't necessarily consider those kinds of activities. Investment tax credits, whether the new market tax credits, the housing development incentive program, which you all passed, which is incentives for market rate housing, historic tax credits, those all are additional tools that we have added and layered on in this district to really bring it up to a market rate, market-ready activity center.
Okay. So really, the TIF, the old TIFs that were tax incremental financing that we're aware of, that would still be utilized potentially outside of that district?
Correct, correct. There's plenty of opportunity to use TIF outside of this area. DIF, we're just taking that increment and sharing it with...
Within that locus
within
right
the whole locus area.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr.
Thank
Chairman.
You, sir.
Thank you, Councilor Rodriguez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. May, how are you?
Good evening, sir.
With respect to some of the questions that were actually raised here tonight, I have a problem with the way this order was written. Because when you look at it, it basically says and authorizes the planning department to take any other action in connection with the approval of the district. I think one of the things that it does, it takes the authority away from this body. I mean, you're saying in that, you know, anytime any sort of finances, the monies get moved around one way or the other, it has to come back to this body. But on this, based on this language right here, it does take that authority away from us.
I'm sorry, sir. I disagree. The way that the language is...
Well, read it. Read it and tell me what it says, because that's the way I'm seeing it.
It's giving me, my department the authority to meet with Mass Development, meet with the state in setting the boundaries, meet with the assessor's office and the other parties that we need to get a plan approved. It's not giving me any authority for any expenditure or striking any deal. It's basically giving me the authority to work to create the plan and to bring it back to you for approval.
But that's not what it's saying on this order. Because as I see it, you basically developed this plan, so what's to prevent you and your department or some of the folks that you're dealing with to basically kind of redraw it on your own beyond this, because it says that we are giving you the authority to take any other action in connection to the approval of the district.
I don't see it that way.
I'm saying, but that's what it says right here in black and white. I know
I'm reading the same thing, and it says that to take any actions in connection with the approval of this district. And so that's preparing documents, bringing them to you for approval.
Well, I think
it's not giving me the authority to approve the district. Massachusetts General Law 40Q requires this body to approve a plan. It requires this body to approve expenditure of the plan of funds out of this district. It doesn't vest that authority with me.
With all due respect, I understand that, but what I'm saying to you is that this order, the way it is written as we speak, it's not saying that. That's what I'm saying. As it's written, I have a problem approving it. Because until such time that it basically states otherwise,
I think, Council.
Sir, pretty much this is...
If I could intervene just for 1 second, please. I think if you go back to the original order, I think reads differently than what you're seeing just here, which I think is probably a caption to what all four items say here in the original order. I mean, that's the way I'm seeing it, and I don't see it as such.
Well, Mr. Chairman, the reason why I'm bringing this up is several weeks ago, I know that this isn't a forum to talk about this, but since we're talking about DIFT and TIF, a gentleman from the Trinity Project came here in front of us to get authorization for some folks to utilize the garage.
Correct.
If I believe. And one of the promises that we were made, and the reason why I'm bringing that up is, as a veteran, I drove by the Korean memorial at the corner of where Councillor Sullivan brought up the issues that he had brought up. There's now a couch sitting there, something that was just dumped there, and it's sitting there. And to me, when I hear this these beautiful projects being proposed, and yet there's very little follow-up that actually happens beyond signing on the dotted line, I have a concern with that. And I know that we're, you know, that's not what we're talking about here, but the fact is that once organizations and institutions come before this body asking for authorization to do things, it seems that we lose the ability to enforce anything in this community, and that's why I'm bringing that up.
And I understand it, and your point well taken in regards to the other matter. I gave you some leeway in bringing that particular issue up, and we'll, if there's a situation there, then we'll address that issue as well.
There's a couch sitting on.
We'll make sure that, that gets addressed through the clerk's office, because he's the one that worked with them to make sure that they did what they had to do before they obtained their license, which came in regards to he coming back to me as well as Councilor Sullivan, who had raised the issue before we allowed them to make sure that they could do what they could. So we'll correct that one, Councilor. That's another issue, but I think
so,
what I'm...
So returning to the item in question here, I'm looking at the order here, and in number four, basically it's saying the same thing. I actually have a problem with taking any other action in connections with the approval of the district. And until as I said, until that's remedied in the sense, I really have a tough time supporting this. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Okay. Point well taken. Councilor, any other councilors before I go back to Councilor Cruz and Councilor Barnes had a follow-up as well. Go ahead.
Thank you. Just a couple of follow-ups that I had down before that I didn't. One of the things shows here 685 taxable properties. How many of those are condos? It says including separately taxed condos. Ballpark, I mean...
If I can, just a second.
You can get me that information if you want.
I'll have to get you, just by looking at this, I'm seeing 14 off the bat, but I know there's...
No, there's going to be...
I know there's more.
Yeah.
I'm just looking at the numbers that have three digits.
Yeah, if you could get me that, I'd appreciate that. And then, so we established this baseline in the 2016 FY, I guess it is, will be in. Anything for the next 10, 20, is there a time frame on this? I mean, are we approving this in perpetuity?
DIF?
And if, well, okay, first answer that.
A DIF district is for 30 years.
30 years.
Or less, depending on what the council would like to do.
So let's say everything's great and, you know, property values continue to rise. Everything above the baseline for the next 30 years can only be used in this district?
No, everything above the baseline is captured in this district, and then either according to the plan or how the council would like to distribute those funds,
and if
that's
we don't,
how those expenditures
so
are
So in
made.
A particular year, we say, no, we don't want to do that, or there's nothing that is going on. That money is usable in the general fund.
It is possible, yes, sir.
Okay, I mean, when you say it's possible...
Meaning that mass law allows you to do that.
It goes into the general fund and it just becomes tax revenue that then we use as part of our regular...
Yes, sir.
So over the next 30 years, we might have six times that we decide, yeah, it's worth it to do this, to use some of this money. We might have 24 years where it just goes into the general... The increases just go into the general fund.
Generally, it would probably work in the opposite direction where the DIF fund is accumulating a balance to pay for projects as opposed to just allocating it directly to the general fund and then pulling money out.
Well, yeah, I don't see us pulling money out once, you know, once it's in use there.
Yeah.
And I guess that's, so tax bill for building Q over here is $100,000 a year right now. In 20 years, it's $175,000. Every year, are you reestablishing a baseline every year, or the increase of each year is what's available, or everything over that baseline of 2016 FY?
Everything over that baseline. So this, so when you went from 100 to 175, that $75,000 is
so
is what's
30 years from now, 29 years from now, it would still be. Now, we may have adjusted the district some, we may have adjusted what we want to work on, but that money will, so let's say we're wildly successful and really get downtown the way we want it. We could be looking at lots and lots of money, tax increase off that baseline, that is then sitting there unusable for the rest of the city unless we decide to put it in there.
Well, it's usable how you see fit, whether it's inside the district or outside the district. If we are wildly successful and we've paid for all the infrastructure and all the environmental remediation that we need to do, the city may choose to dissolve the DIF.
So, okay, so we can dissolve that?
Yes, sir.
We're not locked into, you know, let's say, and I mean, wildly successful alone could be the freight yards. The freight yards we get $0 from right now, correct?
It would be a substantial increase, yes.
And I mean, I know that's a huge piece of property and something that CSX has not been ever wanted to work with the city on, and they've asked for ungodly amounts of money for the property in the past. I know the baseball stadium was first looked at to go down there.
That's a while.
And it was the amount of money was hundreds of millions of dollars they claimed that was worth, when it probably has $100 million in remediation that it needs. So we can. It's a 30-year DIF, which we could break up at any time, for good or for bad. I mean,
correct.
Success or unsuccessful, this council could choose to disband the DIF.
We can dissolve it at any time.
Dissolve it.
And you can take money and allocate annually those funds coming from the DIF. What you're doing is basically, for accounting purposes, segregating those so that if you have obligations existing or want to make improvements, you know exactly how much you have to work with. And then what's not been allocated in the DIF district can be used anywhere else in the city.
And any new administration in 2, 4, 6, 10, 12 years may choose to use that money in the general fund, but it has to be
with the approval of the council.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor Cruz. Council Barnes, did you have a follow-up?
Yes, just one more thing. Not to open another can of worms, but in the proposal, you also mentioned there was some talk about kind of how to, I guess, integrate this particular program with maybe something else or something that might be coming down the pike. But in the proposal, you mentioned about the urban renewal. And how does that fit in to, I guess, some of the concerns that have been brought up by my council, the councilors here?
We are creating and we have a team working right now that's led by the city and Mass Development and several other organizations throughout the city that are working on a revitalization strategy for downtown. Mm-hmm. It's taking some of the existing plans. There's a lot of good work out there, but we're putting it into an actionable agenda. Mm-hmm. And assigning partners. But as part of that, there are certain projects that need to be funded, catalytic projects that will allow other activities to take place. Mm-hmm. Some of those are site acquisitions, some of it's infrastructure improvement. And infrastructure, of course, is easy to do because it's in our right-of-way. But there are properties that may need to be acquired, and that is where we're looking at potentially doing urban renewal downtown. Again, that is a project that would, a plan would have to come before this body to be approved. Mm-hmm. It would also have to be approved by the Commonwealth. And then anytime we use that, the expenditures for urban renewal could be coming out of the DIF fund. And, heavy power that urban renewal has, we're not taking anybody's property for free. We have to pay for that market value, and then usually we end up in court for a pro tanto decision. That's one of my favorite legal words. where a court arbitrator says, you know, it's really a little bit more than what you've assessed through the assessor's office, and so you pay a little bit extra. That's the money needed to acquire those properties is where DIF would come into place. And we don't look at urban renewal, I don't look at urban renewal as a let's wipe the map clean. What we're, our strategy is to put as many incentives in place for the existing property owners to make wise choices on the redevelopment of their property, whether it's historic tax credits, new market tax credits, improvements in zoning that allow more density and more development. We want to put as much carrot out there. But every once in a while, you get one or two properties that, that muck up the situation, and you need a little bit of a stick.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor. Any other questions, concerns from the
council? Motion to recommend favorably.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded to recommend favorably back to the full city council. All in favor? Opposed? Goes back to the full city council.
Mr. Chairman, can you just council. Give me a little latitude for 1 second to
sure,
talk
council.
To the city planner?
Yes,
Mr. May, if you could, just to follow up, I was going to bring this up, but I think my colleague at large brought it up. If you could contact the powers that be at Trinity, because it is deplorable. When myself and the president and Councilor Stadenski and the city clerk went to look at the site, it was covered with a green tarp. This is across from Legion Parkway, the Korean War Memorial. It was a green tarp, so you couldn't really see in through the fence. As of today, that tarp is gone, and it's deplorable. There's rubbish there, there's bags, there's debris, there's a couch, it's broken concrete. I mean, it's really disrespectful. It's part of the license approval by this party.
Yes, sir.
It was represented that they would clean that up and make it impeccable, and it's not. So if you could please pass that on. Because if it's not done soon, we're going to go through the process of potentially trying to either revoke or suspend that license.
Thank you.
Thank
and,
you.
And through the chair, I do want to, I have been in contact with them about the redevelopment schedule for that park. They should be working on that relatively quickly. I have mentioned it several times that it's an important element for the city, and they can't just stop at their boundaries. So they are aware of our concern. I will bring that back up to them tomorrow. Or even text on my way home.
If you could.
Not while I'm driving.
No, but we will be meeting here again Monday night.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very
Council.
Much.
Thank you, Mr. May.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Madam Clerk, the next item.
Order that the City Council of the City of Brockton petitions the Great and General Court under the provisions of Section 8 of Article 89 of the Amendments to the Constitution of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts for an act as follows, an act authorizing the City of Brockton to impose a local sales tax on certain sales of medical marijuana. Invited Michelle Dubois, State Representative, City Councilor.
Councilors, Councilor Dubois had put this on the agenda a few months ago and asked that it be brought to this particular meeting this evening. She's not here. And I don't
make a motion to postpone to August.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. We postpone to the next finance meeting in August. All in favor? Opposed? We'll postpone it to the August finance meeting. Thank you. Madam Clerk, we have the last item.
Resolved that the City Council hereby requests that a representative and or representatives of the query appear before the Finance Committee to address questions pertaining to the desalinization water contract. Invited John A. Conan, Chief Financial Officer, Philip Nazarella, City Solicitor, Moises Farriente, General Manager, Aquaria Water, Andrew Kahn, Attorney for William Cutler, Pickering, Hale, and Dorr LLP, Alfredo Andres, Anima USA Corp., and Peter Fairbanks.
Good evening, gentlemen, and I believe Mr. Parente, if you could probably come forward and introduce. I know
Mr. Chairman, if I could.
Names on. I just want to finish, Council. There's a couple of new names that have been added, and I'd like you to introduce who they are and what role they play within within the organization at this point in time.
Yeah, good afternoon. Mr. Peter Fairbanks is the president of Aquaria, and Andrew Kahn is our attorney.
Very good. Thank you. Thank you, gentlemen, for being here this evening as well. Councilor Sullivan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for being here. Just for everybody in attendance and those watching on TV, as you recall, I actually filed this resolve 16 months ago, March of 2014. And previously, I filed a similar resolve with the legislative session of 2011 through 2013. Mr. Parente did come before this body one time in the last 16 months, and I am thankful that they're here tonight. However, I am again dismayed because when the individual was here at that time, I made it clear, respectfully, I asked for any and all written materials relative to marketing, and at that time, it was an assurance that this body would have those materials prior to your next appearance. Again, it's taken months and months and months. But I don't have any materials, and I don't believe my colleagues have any materials. If you have them there tonight, that's fine, and we'll deal with it. But there was a representation made that we would have any and all materials prior to your next appearance. That never came to fruition for whatever reason. As I made it clear back in 2011, and I'll make again clear in 2015, there's supposed to be a business relationship, a partnership between the city of Brockton and your business. And you're being paid handsomely for that. And I understand, you know, why that is, and I understand there's a contract, although I think we need to revisit that. However, the fact that you have legal counsel here tonight, I'm glad, being a lawyer myself, I'm glad that that's the case. But I just, for the life of me, Mr. Parente, I can't understand, because I spoke to you right near the elevator that night when you were leaving, and I said, I apologize if you thought I was harsh on you, but we need, as the 11 bodies of the city council that represent everybody that votes and everybody that pays taxes and everybody that is a vested business partner in Aquaria, we have to get the answers, and only you can give those to us. And you promised me, sir, that we would have those, and we don't. So the fact that you're here tonight, great. I understand probably why you're here tonight, since there was a cut made at budget. But with that being said, the fact is we don't have the materials to be able to ask you thoughtful, well-vetted out questions. And that puts the legislative body, all 11 of us, at a really disadvantage to ask intelligent, articulate questions that get to the scope of the original resolve. So again, I'm dismayed that we don't have what we need. With that being said, I'm glad you're here, and let's move forward and see what we get out of it tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Councillor. Good evening, if whoever wishes to speak first in regards to the resolve that was filed several months ago in the presence of you here this evening is very important to us. So if you want to begin, we appreciate that.
Do you want me to provide background, or do you want me to respond to specific questions? I'd be happy to provide background to the contract. I have been involved with the project from its inception.
Well, I think we could probably, I could go from council to council and see if there's specific questions, but I think what we're probably looking to hear is just where we are at today in regards to the contract and the marketing piece of it, because as Councilor Sullivan said, I think that's what's been most important and troubling to us as a city council, is just where have we gone, what route have we taken, and what are we trying to do to sell the water to other communities within. And we've never really gotten any type of a straight answer at all. I know Moise has been here a few different times and addressed the matter. If he wants to come up and pitch first, then that's fine, and let us know where we stand, that we can do that. If you have other information, then I'd like to hear from you, and then we can take whatever questions the council has. But I think Councilor Sullivan's correct, too. We don't have anything in front of us so that we could ask, you know, other intelligent questions that we want to ask in regards to the contract in itself. And quite honestly, as the city council president, as a city councilor, I only can indicate, you know, from I came on when the contract had already been signed. I was not a councilor or part of that process, but I know that we're limited to, as a council, to what we can do within the contract at that particular point in time. The council before signed off, as far as I look at it, they signed a waiver that they would never have any type of a say in regards to the contract, so that changed that a little bit into what we can and cannot do. But we have taxpayers we have to answer to, and I think that was surely shown to all of you involved in regards to how and just what transpired when we passed the budget just a few weeks ago. We understand what legally, logistically can be our situation as yours as well. But, you know, we're just trying to get to some type of root of what we can all do together collectively. So that being said, then I let you, start, and then we can ask some questions, and we can take it from that point. How's that?
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
The point made both by yourself and Councillor Sullivan about this being a partnership, this was a long development process. It involved gathering together easements and pipeline rights of way for 16 miles, both with private owners, with the MBTA, with other easements, five cities and towns, and all of the agreements that had to be entered into. All of this was done at the sole risk of the development entity. So if all of this failed, and we didn't get the permits, all of those at-risk dollars that were invested were at, that was a partnership with the city, but those were entirely Aquarius cost. The city's risk dollars were zero from inception. So that part of the partnership involved a great deal of risk and many, many years of work, putting together all of the permits, applying for the permits. When it was all permitted, there was still a major element where the city had to get a permit. And it needed to go, and it went, and it got a decision with respect to its water use that deeply affected the marketing ability. It came back with limitations that said there would be a 65-gallon per day limit that was going to be imposed, in effect, per capita, and there had to be less than 10% unaccounted for water loss. So that was now a permit restriction that came into affecting this plant, and it came when the city went for its part of the permitting. That restriction made it very difficult to gather other contracts from other towns. More than 20 towns have been marketed and had multiple discussions, and almost every case, so we have Taunton, Abington, Rockland, Avon, Berkeley, Dighton, Easton, Foxborough, Hanson, Holbrook, Randolph, Mansfield, Norton, Plainville, Raynham North, Raynham Central, Town of Sharon, Town of Somerset, Town of Swansea, Town of West Bridgewater, Town of Weymouth, I repeated that, I'm sorry, Town of Whitman. We also talked to a number of private entities, some of which you know about and some of which were not favorably received by you, Brockton Power Company, Tri-Town Development, Taunton Casino, and others. But the constraints on the permit were one of them. With respect to Norton, they actually wanted to go through with that, but were not able to do so from their permitting. I don't say this with an act of defensiveness. I'm saying that things evolved over the course of spending millions of dollars on permitting, millions of dollars to acquire the land, millions of dollars to acquire the easements and rights of way and permits and Executive Office of Transportation and Construction, dealing with opponents of the project who went into various forums. Finally, so after a contract in 2002, all of the permitting and the permits that the city came back with, we finally were ready to produce water in 2008. We borrowed a great deal of money. Those loans are still outstanding. When we were seeking permitting and contacted our financing parties early in 2003, 2004, one of the things they said was, this is not a long-term contract. It won't work for financing purposes because of 30B, the procurement statute, section 12. And under 12F, they noted that in the general laws, there is an exception for the annual appropriation clause that applies to sewage plants, sludge plants. It does not mention water plants. And the lenders said, either amend 30B, section 12F, or get a private home rule petition. We came to the city, our partner, and said, we can't get financing. Here's their requirement. What would you like to do? And a decision was made to go forward with a home rule amendment, which was passed by the general court. I had to testify. Others in the city supported it. This was something in which we all thought there was a market. I'm sure you realize that we thought we would be selling you a lot of water, not just capacity payments. We thought we would be selling you a lot of water, and we wanted to. So that's a long way of saying we were trying to market those. I drafted contracts for the city of Norton, delivered them.
I put together a number of letter agreements and correspondence, so I do know it was happening. I'm not part of when this material was delivered, but let me stop there. I was trying both to give you background but to be responsive to the points about reaching out to other cities and towns.
Let me take Councilor Cruz first and then Councilor Sullivan. Yes. Councilor Cruz.
Well, no, I'm sorry. Is it Mr. Fairbanks or Mr. Andres?
My name is Andrew Cohn. I'm a partner.
Well, you're the attorney.
I am the attorney.
Okay. So it sounds like you guys get into this terrible contract too. But from your end, you knew about the city's the restraints that were put on the city's permits before you built the plant. You were complaining about the 65 gallons, the constraints put on the city permits. You knew about those before you broke ground and you signed the contract.
No, we did not know them before we signed the contract. We signed the contract, then we permitted and spent all our money, got all our permits, all our rights.
All the permits, but you had not built.
We had not built, and then at the very end, it was time when we were ready, before breaking ground, for you to get your permits. It was only then, after millions had been spent, land secured, easements secured, permits obtained, DPU approval, and by the way, the DPU approval was, you know, focused on municipalities. Then, and only then, did you go for your permit. That was a condition that you wanted to have. You said, we're not going unless you guys have delivered. We delivered, but at that point, there was nothing we could change about our project. We were not expecting that result. So, yes to the question, it was before we broke ground, but no, we didn't know about it at the time of the contract signing, nor during virtually all of the permitting.
But you could have walked away before you spent the $80 million in construction costs, or whatever number.
At the time, you wanted us to break ground. We had committed in our contract, it included construction obligations. So we were merely following through on that which you, our partner, had imposed on us.
Okay, well, that part's fine. The key words, two things that just ring, and I have to tell you that I've been pretty much the defender of this plant in this group. And it's been, and I, first of all, I want to apologize to my fellow councilors because I came up with an idea about 2 months ago that we would just hold your check here until you showed up. They decided, and I told them, they're crazy, it won't make any difference, but they cut the payment out of the budget, and I commend you because obviously it worked. By cutting the amount of money out of the budget, we finally have our partners here. That's kind of what really embarrasses me. You talk about being partners, and we've been, I believe it's 16 months of every finance meeting reading this resolve and having no one show up, and all we asked Mr. Parente for when he was here the last time was show us some of the paperwork that you use for marketing. You talk about letters to these towns. You could have emailed those to us and satisfied the question that most of these councilors had. Instead, you chose to embarrass your partners, refuse to come and talk to your partners. I have to tell you, if I was a municipality somewhere else looking to deal with Aquaria, I would be just looking at what's happened to us here. And I'm not talking about whether the idea of the plant. I can tell you when we lost our main coming up from Silver Lake, month and a half ago, it was important that we had this secondary source of water. I still believe it's important that we have this secondary source of water. The things that have made the contract not so attractive for both of us probably couldn't have been foreseen. We didn't know that we were going to need less water than we didn't know that we were going to fix all the leaks coming up from Silver Lake. We didn't know that building was going to drop off the face of the earth. So both of us are in a contract that isn't great. All we asked as a body was for our partner to tell us what you had done for marketing. Show us a flyer, show us a letter that you had gone, just so we could say to our constituents, they're trying, they're trying. Instead, Mr. Parente showed up at one meeting, or maybe two if you go back 4 years or 5 years, and promised, even after the meeting was over, I'll get you that paperwork. I still don't have any paperwork. You probably have brought some things with you tonight. That helps. Let me ask you a question as far as marketing goes. When was the last time you talked to any of these towns?
I'm not going to answer that at the moment. I will pass it on to Mr. Perriente. The only thing I would say, and I do hope you appreciate and that the councillors appreciate, that an awkward situation was created in which the city was also negotiating with my clients to buy the plant. And there, that created some legal difficulties about can you be doing certain presentations versus dealing with negotiations. All I would say, I'm not going to go into excuses, I'm just going to say to you, but for those complications, some of the timing things which appear to have been a source of feeling insulted, for which we apologize, stemmed from complicated, at least judgment calls about being on sort of two different postures. So that you can put it down to either bad judgment on my part or oversensitivity, but some of that is in the background as explanation.
Well, Hale and Dorr, well, now Wilmer Cutler Pickering Hale and Dorr, is a pretty big law firm. A letter from them might have given me the ability to say, we've heard from their law firm, and right now they say they can't come to us. You're an attorney, I'm not. Attorney Sullivan is, but he's not here as an attorney, he's here as a counselor. We never, ever heard a word from the Constant. We sent registered letters, we made every outreach in the world, and did not hear back. Occasionally, Mr. President would get an email the day of a meeting to say, I can't be there tonight. That makes us, and it's not about being embarrassed, it's about not being able to talk to our constituents with any kind of information. You couldn't have sent us a letter, any kind of, in your opinion, again, Hale and Dorr, one of the top law firms in the world, to my knowledge, if you had sent a letter, I would have had to go to our council, legal counsel of this city council, or the city solicitor, and say, geez, is that real? Is that their opinion going to be? And he would have probably said, if that's their opinion, we're going to have to go by it right now. But we never heard a word. And again, the person that's getting on you the most is the one that has told every one of these councillors, we need that water plant. We actually, long term, we need that water plant. It's a terrible contract right now for both of us, evidently. But just some information, and nobody could even reach out and say, geez, I can't come and talk to you right now. There's other things going on. There's negotiations going on. I mean, I have to be honest with you, that sounds like he still could have come and talked to us. We specifically asked about one thing. We asked about marketing outreach and what had been done. That's all we asked. The contract this body has beat to death for the last 5 years. The public knows it's not great. It is what it is. Maybe over the course of 25 years, we're going to say it was a good thing. But I can tell you right now, we asked for information on marketing. What marketing and outreach had been done to sell water? Because that's our way out, and it's your way out to make some money on the plant. And we could not get an answer whether anything had been done other than a phone call. Yeah, we called all these towns and we asked, no, they don't want water. So I do want to hear from Mr. Perriente. When was the last time you did a marketing outreach to any town?
I personally don't do it. There is staff here that is actually in charge of doing that.
So when was it?
I can.
You don't have any information on when
the
last?
I do. I brought the information that you requested.
Could you look through it and tell me the last time that there was some outreach done by your representative? I mean, it's you in the contract, not you personally, but it's Aquaria,
right,
that is responsible for trying to sell water to other entities. Can you tell me the last time that you or your representative, whoever you hired, but they're your agent, whether the word is legally the right word, I don't know. When was the last time they reached out to a city or town or private developer to a private water concern to sell water?
End of last year, there was conversations with, and I think I brought here, I think at the end of last year I was here, and I told you that they had some discussions with the town and casino.
With what?
The casino in Taunton.
Okay, which is not even a, there is no casino in Taunton.
Right.
So you talked about something
the
that
parade,
maybe...
Yes.
So you talked to an outfit that maybe 10 years down the road, after the federal government, you know, so... And do we have any paperwork showing us that?
No. No, I brought you the information of the of all the municipalities that we have talked about the project and probably joining to on the I mean taking water from or purchasing water from Aquaria and all the towns and I mean municipalities and private companies are here.
Well, I hope when I look at it that I see recent. I'm the director of sales and marketing at the company I work at.
Mm-hmm.
And when my salespeople say, no, we didn't, get, you know, we're not doing well here, we don't stop. We go back 6 months, a year later, maybe a year and a half. The world changes. And from all we know, you did outreach years ago when it first started, and the gentleman that you had here with you the last time, I forget his name, but has been doing, he, I believe, is one that does, is your consultant that was doing the outreach. It had all been fairly early in the contract, and since then, to our knowledge, there hadn't been any other outreach. I can tell you that the town of Holbrook wanted to buy water and could not get in touch with anybody.
One thing I would want to point out under the contract is that the contract had an obligation and the marketing obligation had a dollar amount, which
exactly. We
well exceeded. The other part of this, though, is that the city of Brockton has very substantial rights under the contract. It can sell water, it can wheel water, there are unusual provisions that allow it to wheel water. So for cities and towns, for municipalities, having a water commission contact other water commissions and say, hey, we've got this water, you could have chosen to put it at various different prices. I just want one other thing. This unusual contract from which you have, except in the emergency conditions, essentially taken no water, has a provision that you have a call right on 24 hours notice. So we have been running a plant, being ready to serve you with waters every day, day in, day out, on 24 hours notice. And no one has come to say, you know what, you can lower your costs and, you know, basically mothball this because we want you, we, and so we're there for you. But I do want to point out that this was not a marketing obligation that went on ad infinitum during the 20 years of the contract. We did do it, we will demonstrate that, and we'll certainly cooperate. We did bring other candidates. I know it may be a sore subject, but the Brockton power plant was very ready to take our water, and lots of it. And I understand there were other reasons and other factors, and that's all within your decision, but I spent lots of time and money trying to get that to be a source of water.
And that may be, the question we had is show us where the money was spent. That's what the question was the last time Mr. Prente was here. If you fulfilled your part of the contract, that's all we were asking, is we have never seen where those marketing dollars went. It was a question we asked. I don't think it would be all that difficult if it was done to show us where those were spent. It's a contract that we have the right to see that you spent that money. Once you said you spent the money, if you fulfill the contract, you fulfilled it. The problem is, by just avoiding coming here, we have no way of knowing if you fulfilled your part of that part of the contract. If you fulfilled it, then we can sit here and say we're mad and we don't like it, but if you fulfilled it, you've done it. All we asked for was the information showing us that you fulfilled it. And I still don't see anything like that.
I will leave to Mr. Pariente and his staff to continue to follow up on that. I would say that the structure of this contract was based upon capitalistic principles,
sure,
of profit motive and incentive. And
but you're in a contract.
So the one part is, part of your question is, fully fair, you know, show us that.
Show us.
But another part of the another one implies that we would have no incentive to do this marketing, that it was to our advantage to just sit on our hands. And I'm sure we can all agree that's not the case.
I agree with that. And that's why it's so confounding to this council that Mr. Parente couldn't have come in 2 weeks after he was here the last time and said, here's what we spent. Here's the invoices to our consultant. Whatever it is, we've spent the amount of money we promised, and anything after that, I mean, I agree. I've sat and talked with every one of these councils. They can tell you, I've been the one that has said, no, we need this power plant. I mean, this water plant. And then to be constantly not given the information so we could back up, so I could back up that, no, the contract is, it's not good for either one. I mean, to listen to what you're saying to me tonight, sounds like you'd like to say, let's rip up the contract. And I bet you'd get an 11-0 vote in this room to rip up the contract. That's not going to happen. I know that. It's a plant that's now built and at some point needs to... And by the way, you'd have a tough time shutting that down and mothballing it too, because then it's just a hunk of iron for you. I know that too. We all know that.
You're correct.
You're running at a minimum because it's good for you also. Is it to fulfill a contract? Absolutely. And it has happened sometimes that we've needed the water. And sometimes we've taken it just to keep the pipes going. We understand that. All we asked for, and again, now I'm getting redundant, but all we asked for was show us that you've fulfilled the contract. And instead, we had somebody who just avoided. When somebody avoids you for a year and a half, or a year, you tend to think that maybe they don't have that information. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Sullivan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Attorney Cohn, I just wanted to, I don't know if you were privy to the actual resolve, but it was read in to the record by the clerk, but the last paragraph was not, and it says, in addition, the City Council requests that the representative and or representatives of Aquaria provide any and all information, data, and or documents relative to the marketing of the water as per the terms of the contract agreement. That was the whole gist of the resolve that I filed. It was also the gist of the original resolve that I filed in 2011. Again, it was simply, show us how you market it. I asked Mr. Parente that day, do you go to the MMA? He didn't even know what the MMA was, Mass Municipal Associations, where they have booths, they have expos. I used to be the town attorney for the town of Randolph for 5 years. I was never, ever approached by Aquaria or the town manager my tenure there. Maybe it was previous. We were never told, this body was never told that 20 towns, you gave us that information tonight, 20 towns had been contacted relative to this. That's a simple number. If that's a fact, that should have been reiterated to us 16 months ago. So I guess I don't understand, not even as a lawyer, I guess as a common sense standpoint, why information requested couldn't be given. If the statement made was on advice of legal counsel, we don't want you to appear before that body, I can appreciate that. I do think that a letter to our legislative counsel or to Mr. Nezarella, the solicitor, would have really done yeoman's work. But I guess I find troubling is, if that's the case, and we're the legislative body, we're not the mayor administrator, why are you here tonight if those are still ongoing with the mayor? You know, I find that a bit of a quagmire. You're here tonight to answer our questions, but for 16 months we've been looking for these questions. And again, you weren't here that night, sir, but it was conveyed to us, undoubtedly, we will give you anything that we have. When we asked the question of who have you talked to, Mr. Parente said the casino people, potential casino people in Taunton. That was it. You know, these 20 towns, I'd like to know when exactly they were contacted. I would like to know that because I'm going to reach out to them as well just to verify that. But I think as a collective legislative body, the whole idea of a resolve, we don't have subpoena power. The resolve is to invite someone to come in before us, and it's a Q&A. And when Mr. Parente came before us many, many, many months ago, he didn't have the answers to any of our questions. So we decided to postpone that so that it would give him time to generate the documents. And again, it was made clear that's what we need. And the answer was, you'll have it. Well, then there was no appearance. And it became kind of a joke. I was the council president last year. It became kind of a joke on when the cancellation process will happen. Will it be the Friday before the Monday? Would it be the Sunday night at 8:09 where we got emails at 8 o'clock? Would it be the day of? And again, that's not you as legal counsel, but it goes to the idea that Brockton is paying a ton of money, millions of dollars per year, and we have a contract, and we're abiding by the obligations, and you would stipulate that your client is abiding by the obligations. One caveat there is to just give information to us so that we can convey it back, and that just has, it's failed. It's failed since 2011 when I originally sent this resolve in. Of course, it would have continued, but it died when the legislative session ended. So, again, the whole gist of this was to get the information. That book here tonight is great, but it's not helpful to me or the other tenant that sit on this body because we haven't seen it. So, do you have the dates of when those 20 towns, municipalities were contacted? Do you know when about that was?
I do not. I know the period, a lot of it occurred while we were still permitting. I know, for example, that while I was working on the contract with the City of Brockton, I was also drafting and finalizing a contract with the City of Norton. And that during that time frame, and this is something, so during a period prior to 2008, we were going through lists of cities and towns to whom to make approaches, how much would they take. The City of Norton, I believe, had 0.5 million gallons per day, so 500,000 gallons per day, nothing like the City of Brockton's. But the information that was prepared tonight does not have all of the details that you are requesting of date and time. I think it can be done for time frames. I saw a great deal of it happening, but it was not done with my sending letters. For example, I'm expensive and they were already paying me quite a bit of money to permit things. We would have phone sessions. The representative of Bluestone would approach some towns, the representatives of Aquaria, who had an office set up with people here virtually all the time. They had a local office. And sometimes I would go to meetings there, sometimes not, but I know they were doing outreach. I don't think that we do have something to be delivered tonight. I don't think it, from what I'm hearing of the details you're requesting, I don't think it goes to the level of granularity that you're requesting, but I certainly think it is a good faith submission. And you can decide if you want additional granularity. I think it would be time frames. I can speak to some of those. I could give an affidavit as to some of it. I know the reason you're asking. It's something that you wanted to see what was done. I will say to you that they've been desperate to sell water. I at some point, with the permit that came in right near the end, that I'm repeating myself, but I was explaining, at some point, you know, you've talked to people and they've said no. And I understand there's some sales work that you do where you keep coming back until people throw you out. But these are cities and towns, and when they say, no, we've thought about it, we're going to go in a different direction, how many times do you knock on the door?
And I could concur with that, but I do know, being a municipal attorney, that when businesses want to come to a city or town, they will bring, be it a solar bright field or even a billboard company, they will bring materials of past practices, of successes. Those are the things that I had asked for. And it was a simple inquiry, whereas this would have been a dead issue in 2011 if information was brought before that legislative council at that time and said, this is what we did, this is who we talked to, this is the success rate, blah, blah, blah. That would have been it. But it wasn't. And then there was the blow-off and the continuous blow-off of non-appearance. And again, I can appreciate being a lawyer if you feel that it wasn't in your client's best interest, but what stupefies me as an attorney is that when I do that for clients, I'll send a letter to verify that, to take it to the forefront for my client, and that didn't happen. But that's a different issue. The simple inquiry was, who are you marketing to and how are you doing it? There's two questions. That was it. And again, as of right now, July 20th, 2015, I still don't know. So that book is great, and I mean, I'm not going to ask you for an affidavit. I don't think that's appropriate, but I do know when the mayor and the city solicitor was sitting there many, many months ago, I pled to them. These guys aren't coming before us. They're thumbing their noses at the city council. Maybe you'll have better luck. And again, I just find it ironic now that money is cut from the budget and you're here tonight. So, I mean, again, thank you for being here. I'm going to have my colleagues ask other questions. I'm going to make a motion at the end, councilors, to postpone this matter so that we can vet that out and look through it. And again, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Barnes?
Yes, sir. I kind of just want to ask Mr. Pariente, were you the one that received the notices, or was it, maybe it could be Attorney Cohen, who received the notice that we would send every week?
They are received at the plant.
At the, okay.
Dighton, yeah.
So who opened it? Who got it and said, oh, the Brockton City Council humbly requests your appearance to blah, blah, whatever?
When, tonight? I mean, for the appearance?
For the entire time that we've been sending them.
Who opens them? Staff at the plant.
Okay, so someone you don't know?
Oh, no, someone I know, obviously, yes.
Okay, did you receive them? Did you physically receive them in your hand?
I do. I do. I get it.
Through the chair.
Yes.
I was just going to explain that our clerk would send out two notices, one to a former employee, she's no longer employed, Rebecca, locally here in the Commonwealth, and we would also send one to this gentleman. We would send out two through the clerk. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Okay, so that's confirmation that they were sent.
They were, exactly, and we have that information back as well.
Okay. You received them in your hands, correct?
I got it by email, yes.
Okay.
I get it by email.
What did you do when you saw it? Over and over and over and over and over and over again. What did you do? What was your thought process for not coming at least once?
It came last year.
That's my point.
It came last year. Yeah, no, I know.
That's my point. Why did you not acknowledge it? Or even in some of those times, like my brother said, that, you know, maybe the day of, we'd get a notice that someone was in Miami or some other kind of thing that nobody could come to the meeting. That's what I want to ask. How could you just blatantly disregard? And earlier, and before I had to step out, and I apologize for that, you mentioned about this being a partnership. I couldn't do business, I mean, alone, personally, I couldn't do business with a partner that completely disrespected and openly defied me every single time we tried to do business. And as my brothers were saying, that was the only thing that we were trying to do, was to just gather some just general, kind of even throwaway information. Just, what are you doing? Well, we reached out to the town of Norwell, we'll get back to you with what they said, or we're, you know, we're hitting the bricks or whatever. What did you do, and how did you come to the conclusion that you felt you didn't need to even acknowledge the notices, now that I know that there were two? What did you do? You.
I replied back whenever I couldn't come.
No, you didn't.
I did.
No.
Some of them, for instance, tonight's notice, I got it today. I knew in advance that it was we were in front of you guys, and I made my trip yesterday. But I mean, some of the times, and I've told we got them the same day of the meeting.
I'm going to intervene into that one, because you received the notice maybe today or whenever you received it, but yeah, you did have conversation with Mr. Condon, I believe, previous to the whole course of this past week, because he and I had discussion in regards to making sure that you had been spoken to, and I have the emails to see that as well, because
I got a call and I got an email, right. And so that's why I'm here
notice
today.
Wise but yeah,
right.
Other than that, he reached out right away though, and to his credit,
no,
I mean, that's, yeah, I just want to make sure,
agree with,
because
that
Mr. Condon was the whole lead in making sure that this was even to happen this evening through I and not through the mayor, Mr. Condon was the lead man, so I just want to make sure that we're clear on that.
I received a notice dated July 14 today, but I had already been informed by Mr. Pariente last week that it was tonight, and I made myself available.
Okay, but I guess I'm just asking all of the others, and I get that you're kind of, you know, hanging and swinging on the fact that you're here right now. That's great for right now, but I'm talking about, you know, I mean, I'm fairly new here, so since I've been here, Councillor Sullivan and Councillor Rodriguez, they've been requesting that the Aquarius situation be looked into and that you all come. And I was actually here one of the days that you did come, and it was a situation where, oh, I'll get it.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I requested to be notified by email, One of the times that I was notified by email, I was sitting back there, and I saw that at the end of the meeting there was, that I wasn't even on the agenda, and I left. But that's why we asked them to notify us by email.
You came one time, and this was not on the agenda?
Yes. I was notified by email, yeah. I was sitting back there.
Okay, so
There was one time towards the tail end, I believe, of Councilor Sullivan's presentation.
Point of information, if I could. Two points of information I think they're important. When the individual did appear here before this party, before we postponed it, we asked him what would be good for his schedule relative to travel plans.
Right.
And he told us the next month. So we continued to the next month. He didn't appear. There was one time when I was present that he sat in the back. He was not on the agenda because we had postponed it for the second month.
Okay, thank you. I guess I'm just, I don't know what to say. I don't think I was prepared for this moment because, like Councilor Sullivan said, it's just a commonplace that no one from Aquaria would ever come. So it's a pleasure to see you, and, you know, whatever information you have there in your book, I'll be, you know, excited to read it and to look and look forward to speaking with you again in person about what's in there.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Rodriguez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You're welcome.
Who's Mr. Fairbanks? Mr. Fairbanks, you're the president of the company.
I am president of Aquaria, yes.
President of Aquaria. Are you aware that this body, and I don't know if you know this or not, but this form of government is, we run in a form of government that it's a strong council, a weak mayor system? Are you aware of that?
Vaguely, yes.
Okay. Were you aware that this body has been trying to get in touch with Aquaria for, I too am fairly new on the council, but I've been here, this is my second year, and I believe every single finance council meeting that we've had, Aquaria has been on the agenda. Were you aware that we were looking for you?
Well, let me explain. Being president of Aquaria, I'm the minority partner of Aquaria. And being president is somewhat of a figurehead position. That gives me the right to call meetings, but my majority partner generally operates the plant and is responsible for everything.
And who's that?
I'm sorry?
Who is that?
That is Anima.
Anima. Are they based in the United States?
Anima has an office in the United States, yes.
Are they aware of the issues that we have with Aquaria?
Yes, they are.
They are? And what do they feel about that, do you know?
I'm sorry?
What do they feel about this issue that we're having with Aquaria?
The issue of...
The fact... I'm going to come back and basically let you know that I'm the one that actually proposed to cut the funding out of the budget. Because, frankly, as Councilor Cruz and Sullivan actually said, it was pretty embarrassing in the eyes of the community that we come here on a weekly basis asking you guys to come before us, and yeah, you show up if you want to, there's a little notice that you're coming or not coming. So finally I was actually I was told that the only way that we would get you guys to respond is to do what would affect the operations, and it seems to have worked, because we went from having absolutely no one to having three of you guys here tonight. So it seems to have worked. But the issue that I have is that when you look into an organization such as yours, and I see my namesake up there kind of, you know, giggling and laughing about it like it's not that big of a deal, but in reality, when you look at this thing, you know, you made it sound, Mr. Cohen, that, you know, you guys would, you know, go through all of this work, all these things that you do, but you do realize that the city is actually writing a check for almost $6.5 million every year to Aquaria, right?
Yes. Thoroughly aware of that.
Okay.
And
so
we had wanted this project to be a success for both of us. Success has many parents. Failure is always an orphan. Now, the one part, I understand the prerogative of this council to delete this, but I do want to say that you may draw the conclusion that the cutting of the money is the reason we're here. I don't agree with you on that, because there is, under the various statutes and special laws, the cutting of that appropriation will not defund this project. So I understand that you want to do it and may choose to do it, and I'm not trying to argue with you about it, but I do want to speak up for the respect that my client has for the city. There have been awkwardnesses for which I have apologized because of the structural tension between two different things going on simultaneously. So I apologize for that, and there may have been better ways in which to have communicated that to the city. But we're not here because you cut the appropriation.
Well, I find it hard to believe, and I know a lot of times we keep quoting who's a lawyer, who's not a lawyer. I might not be a lawyer, but I did graduate from the University of Common Sense. And when that happened, common sense tells me that when the proposed cut actually happened in June, the following day we actually got an email from our CFO. And then we heard from the CFO having contacted or having been in conversation with Aquaria. Prior to that, none of that had happened. So you might be saying that the cutting of the funds had absolutely nothing to do with the fact that you're here tonight. I disagree with that because, again, I've been here in this council for 2 years, and this is the second time I'm seeing your general manager. And the general manager has been asked to come before this body on almost a monthly, if not a biweekly basis. So this is my second time seeing him. So for you to say that the cutting maybe had nothing to do with that stuff, I beg to differ in the sense, because I think it had something to do with that.
And I won't argue with you, Councillor, if that's
and to be honest with you, I think if you were, and he knows what the issues were ahead of time, if you were going to come with the book and you knew you were coming to this meeting several weeks ago, because I was told that Aquaria was coming soon after we approved the cut, which was back in June. We knew that Aquaria was coming, and we're talking July 20th today. So you had plenty of time and opportunity to put together a book for the 11 of us, so we can kind of look at the book and get a sense of what's going on, so that it's not just, you know, private property as far as you're concerned, that the rest of us are just sitting here wondering what's in the book. Do you see what I'm saying?
I do understand, although I will say that I was informed of the meeting last week, and the book was put together by my client. I will say that considering the way in which this hearing has gone, I may want to make the submittal slightly more formal and not just turn over the book tonight, because I'm hearing things that sound very contractual and very aimed at precipitating a potential default, and also what you view as an act to get our attention is actually really considering the special act that was put through by this city. That's a very difficult legal choice.
Let me ask you a question. What would you do in our case? I mean, you're a member of this council. You're sitting here on a regular basis wanting the body to come before you. What would you do?
Well,
what would you have done?
One of the difficulties, and possibly I would have asked for some guidance from the law department to say, if we are simultaneously negotiating possible purchase of the plant and simultaneously having demands made on the counterparty that relate to the potential allegation of contractual breach, is that creating a structural tension that makes this a very awkward and difficult process? Are there some guidelines we should follow here, since those things don't go together that easily?
But you're
Point of information, Mr. Chair, if I could through you. Attorney
yes.
Cohn, though, the original resolve, which is verbatim, is the one that's here before I filed in 2011 under yes. Mayor Belzotti. There was no contemplation at that time to purchase this. This is under the current Mayor Carpenter. So we're talking 3 or 4 years ago, the same inquiry was asked. And again, we weren't given that information. So I find that troubling to say under the cloak of, okay, we're in negotiations with the mayor, but the previous mayor, Belzotti, you weren't under negotiations, and we were looking for that information at that time under the previous legislative council.
That's a very fair point.
Thank you.
And I do not seek to excuse all of our behavior.
Thank you, sir.
You have an apology on that behalf.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councillor.
I'm not done yet.
No, Mr. you're
Chairman.
Not, Councillor.
Go ahead. So, Mr. Cohen, we're not done yet. I think we still have a few minutes left. So basically, why would you not come here tonight with 11 books versus bringing just the one book if you know that there's 11 of us on this council?
I did not coordinate that. I can speak with my client. I don't know the answer. I don't know how many we have, but I also have been in touch and have not had a chance to read all of the submittals. I am not trying to play, you know, hard to get about this material. This is straightforward material, and I would be very happy as long as what I know from hearing the very specific questions of Councillor Sullivan, I know that I don't see the level of granularity in here for which he is asking, and so I think a supplemental would be needed. I am no opposition to putting this in. I have some concerns for my client's rights, but these are essentially public documents, which...
Well, that's what I was about to say, because when you're dealing with a public entity, which we are, there's very little that's private, basically, because on our part, everything is public. So whatever contracts you have with the city or whatever documentations that you have that pertains to the city other than personnel, technically is public record. So there's nothing private in the sense in terms of cutting or, you know, deducting or some things out of your documentation in the sense, because all of that stuff is actually public information.
We concur, Councillor. All I mean is that let's acknowledge that there is structural tension in the air. We are both partners, but also counterparties. And so there is structural tension, and some of it's healthy, and some of it is an unhappy circumstance that has been presented because this is not a happy economic situation for either of us. We do recognize that you are writing very large checks. We would hope it were the case that water had been laid off and sold to others. We'll make this available, but a lot of the marketing to our $250,000 obligation was done in a phase of the project where we'll go back and look, and we do have evidence and we can show. We had colored brochures put together that we were giving out to cities and towns. I don't know where all of that material is now. I saw it. That's why I mentioned an affidavit, not to try to be legally defensive, but to try to give you and the rest of the council evidence that we were working hard and in good faith. This was, by the way, our first project in the United States. So we knew we wanted good reputation from it. I'm sure that's not on your list right now, because I can tell from the tone that we have not succeeded in that, but that was what we were doing. We wanted to make this a demonstration. We worked very hard. And if you need more information after getting these books, I will commit to work with them to try to provide it. Some of it may have to be by affidavit of saying what occurred and how the contacts were made, because I'm hearing Councillor Sullivan say he wants to cross-check that, and that is his right. I am not objecting to that. So, not seeking to be adversarial, but there are frustrations in the air, and I understand them.
Well, let me ask you a point blank question. In your opinion, Do you feel that Aquaria has fulfilled its contractual obligations with the City of Brockton?
Without question.
100%.
100%. But I say that because I know that there was a $250,000 obligation, and they went way over that. We worked on contracts, we worked on marketing, we worked on letters. This is many years ago. We did the effort. These guys were in it to make a profit, to make a profit above the expensive loan, above the expensive operating costs. This contract has no escalations in it. This is, understand, you don't need water now. But let me say, if you needed water, this is a long-term contract with no escalation. It had no protection for us for cost overruns in permitting. No protections for us for cost overruns in construction. That, for example, there was this small project going on simultaneously called the Big Dig, and concrete prices, rebar prices, 50% of all rebar in the United States of America in 2000, I'm not going to get the year right, one of the years of the Big Dig went into the Big Dig, 50% of all U.S. rebar. Now, prices were much higher. Did we have protection on that? Absolutely not. So that was a good part, that was a good contract for the city. This was a very tight contract. In fact, it's one of the toughest we've ever signed. I know that sounds like blandishments, but I'm telling you, this was a very, very tough contract. And we were taking a lot of risk, a lot of dollars spent, and not recompense. In return on investment, very low. So why? First contract in the United States. It had been partly put together. So my answer is an unequivocal yes. You may think it's self-serving, but I've been practicing law for 40 years and I've never sold my soul for a client, and I'm not starting now.
Well, one of the concerns that I actually have is the fact that the surrounding communities that Aquaria has reached out to sell the water, aren't you afraid as a company that they might call members of city government, influential folks in the city, in the sense to ask for an opinion, that perhaps it's something that's keeping those communities from signing on to Aquaria? Because let me ask you something. If a town calls me, other than the fact that I want to get out of this particular mess that we're in right now, what do you think my opinion of Aquaria would be towards those communities?
You make a fair point, and that is the point that, and we are agreeing about one element, and that's the element of time. When I said to you, and I do say unequivocally, that Aquaria met its marketing obligation, it was marketing way before things had soured somewhat. We had not yet fully built the plant. We were permitting. We were moving forward. The city was encouraging us. The Water Commission was doing excellent studies. We looked all at Silver Lake. We looked at contingencies as to what would happen if the water permits that came to the city lowered it by a certain amount, what risk there was. A lot of this was looked at. But during that time frame, we were someone that the city viewed positively. When Norton called the city, they got a very positive response. We put together a contract with them. They were blocked by a different circumstance. I believe it was permitting. Yes, the Massachusetts permitting authorities blocked it. So the answer to your question is, when we were in a very active marketing phase, We did have the city of Brockton as a recommender, as a favorable viewer, and we were busting our butts. I would agree with you now, I'm not unaware of the tension in the room, that if they called you now, that we might not get such a great reception. On the other hand, you have the right to wheel water. You have extensive wheeling rights in it that would let you sell to them and say, you could say, look, we have the water, we can order the water.
I understand that, but as a body, as a legislative body, you know, all we can do is represent the wishes of our constituents. They basically say on a daily basis, what's going on with Aquaria? And we basically have no answers for them because you guys have chosen not to come before this body. Council Sullivan basically brought up the fact that he's been asking for this since 2011. You guys came online in 2008. 2011, 3 years later, there was already questions with regards to whether or not you are doing what you said you were going to do. And this is 4 years later we're talking about, and we're still beating that same old horse.
Let me just do a thought experiment with you and other members of the council. Just assume for a moment, stipulate, even if you don't believe it to be true, although I say it is, that we had met the $250,000 marketing obligation. Let's just, for the moment, put that aside. Now, where are we? Here we are. I understand you may want to still investigate, and it is your right and it is our duty to come forward with that. But just do the mental experiment. Assume we spent $250,000 or more on marketing. That's no longer a contract issue. It's no longer a key for anyone to escape. Even if, whether that was your motive or not, just put it aside. Now where are we? You have a contract that is burdensome economically. We have a contract that's not making us any money. That's where we are together. I have clients in the energy business who spent billions, and then there was this wonderful thing for the United States called shale gas. And now the government of Trinidad Tobago does not want to sell any LNG into Boston. Why? They can get better prices in Europe. We can't compete. The market for gas is gone. So billions of dollars of assets have shifted on us. And I very much appreciate that the councillor was recognizing that the events have changed. Circumstances that neither of us predicted. I'm not crying poor. I'm not poor mouthing you. I'm trying to separate out the issues of contention from where we are stuck together. And yes, it is a partnership. Like a marriage, sometimes there are unhappy times. But we're in a long-term relationship. I don't know if that's helpful, Counselor. I intend it to be.
Once in a while, a good restraining order is good. Yes. But let me ask you, do you know for a fact what is your annual operating cost at that plant?
Yes. Would you like to?
Yes, and I brought, you asked me for the DPE reports, and they are here.
Well, can you just share that with us?
Yeah. Including financing or without the financing?
What does it cost you to operate that plant on a yearly basis? Give me both.
What I'm telling you is that we are losing close to $800,000 every year.
Because of financing or because of
the... No, with the financing, obviously.
What about without the finance?
No, without the financing, we would be we will have obviously a black number, but I mean, it's not... The operating cost is lower than the income that we have.
I know, but can you just tell me what the operating minus the finances?
I have it on my computer. It's easier actually to get it from there, but.
Is that something that you can promise again to send us?
Well, it's right here on the reports, and I can look for it. I'm not sure exactly on what page it is, but it's on the report that I'm giving to you.
Mm-hmm. The only part of that is, assuming a return on capital of zero, without any return on capital, and assuming we had no debt service, which we do have, yes, more income comes in than cost to run the plant.
Well, the reason why I'm saying that is because if you're negotiating with the city overall to in discussions to buy the plant, I just wanted to know what does it cost to operate that plant in Dighton. That's why I was asking.
There is CDM, and I'm sure that's going to be presented to you. Has done a due diligence on that regard. I'll leave you the DPU report, which has all the numbers, and I'm sure CDM will provide that information to you.
And my last question, Mr. Chairman, to you, my namesake, why have you not come to this body when you've been asked so many times to come?
I apologize, and I agree that we were dealing with two issues in parallel, and I probably should have conveyed the message earlier, and I am sorry for that, and I apologize to this committee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councillor. Any other councillors that have any, Councillor Sullivan?
Chairman, if nobody else, I'm going to make a motion to postpone with the caveat good? That I'm going to ask legal counsel or president or general manager if they could make 10 more copies of that book. This would give legal counsel time if he needed to vet anything out or add anything in there. But I think if we can postpone it to the next Finance Committee meeting, which would be when summer session, so that would be what date, Mr. Chair?
I believe August. It would probably be August 20, do I want to say? Anne-Marie, you've got the calendar there for us. I think it's somewhere. Be the third Monday, in August. 24th.
August 24th. I'll make a motion to postpone to August 24th. Second. Finance.
On the motion?
There was a second?
Yes.
Second on the motion.
I just, like, we should get at least 11 copies because the clerk's office will need one for the record.
Yeah, sorry. So that would be the clerk's copy, and then we'd need 11 for each of us.
One for each of us.
On the motion through the chair, Councilor, would it be wise to maybe get that one now and then they add those things later so we can have at least some basis or something?
Yeah, well, we're gonna get
is that something we can do?
Councillor, I appreciate Councillor Sullivan's thoughtfulness in allowing me to review it because it is, I just got it this evening. But we will, if you're asking that it be submitted in advance of that hearing, we will do that. And
yeah,
you can specify the time. And
can we drop that date for that when it would be submitted to the city clerk's office? Like maybe 2 weeks prior to? Would that give you time? 2 weeks prior to?
Yes, it would.
It's because of vacations and the like. So okay. if we could postpone to the 24th with the caveat that we will receive it in the clerk's office 2 weeks prior to that Monday.
Exactly. If we can do that, I think that
thank
works.
You.
That is satisfactory.
Yeah, we are on summer session. So it was. On the motion, Councilor Azay.
On the motion, yes. I just have a couple of questions for Mr. Pariente.
Go ahead.
Mr. Pariente, do you live in this area?
No.
Where do you live?
I lived in Miami, and I'm actually going to be moving, yeah.
You're moving up here, or?
No. Someone else is going to take over.
Oh, somebody else. Okay. Because up to now, you were. What is your position at Aquaria?
General manager.
Okay, and how were you able to manage it from Florida? Did you fly up frequently, or?
Well, we have a project manager, we have a plant manager, we have an administrative assistant, so we have a full office here.
So how often were you up here at the plant?
It depends on the month. Sometimes I come once a month, other times I come twice a month. It depends on the time of the year.
And is that one of the reasons why you weren't able to come before us before, or did that have something to do with why you weren't able to come before City Council?
Say that again, sorry?
Is that one of the reasons you weren't able to come before us is because you didn't live in the area?
No, we were on a parallel process that I should have probably conveyed to the committee, and that was my fault, I guess.
Okay, and last question. My question's usually really short. So you said you were going to be replaced, so are you leaving the company?
No.
Okay. So what did you mean by being replaced?
I'm gonna move to a different location.
So you're relocating?
Yes.
But you will keep the same position at Aquaria?
No. Someone else is going to take over.
So what will your new position be with Aquaria?
In the near future, I won't be taking part with Aquaria business.
So you will no longer be working with Aquaria?
Right.
Okay, near future, this week?
I don't know when.
So you may not be coming before us again is my
right.
question. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Councilor.
You're leaving Aquaria, or you're leaving the general manager's job at this plant?
Well, Aquaria is actually a company owned partially by the company that I work for.
So do you work for ANEMA or for Aquaria?
For ANEMA.
Right. You're going to still be with ANEMA?
Yes.
Correct? If the need arises, will you still be available?
Yes.
To answer questions for us, even if you are no longer working with Aquaria at this plant?
That is correct.
Because that's quite a curveball that just got thrown at us at the last minute here. We're saying, can you, you're going to get us new information and all, and for all we know, you could be in the witness protection program, which is, I think, where you've been.
With that comment, Councillor, allow me to explain. You did put your finger on the distinction. Aquaria is a single-purpose entity. It owns nothing else other than this plant. And it has a venture partner, Bluestone, and a venture partner, ANEMA USA.
I understand that.
And Mr. Parente is with ANEMA and is staying with ANEMA. And so he will be available within ANEMA to assist Aquaria. He's just saying that within the way the company works, Aquaria has its office here, and his jurisdiction for this part of the world is shifting slightly, but he remains with ANEMA and
available to this group if the need arises.
Yes.
And you are giving me your word on that. No, I'm asking you.
I may have to. I don't know if I can arrest him if he's outside the country, but I will make my best effort to get him here.
Is he going to relocate outside of the U.S.?
Yes.
You are?
Yes.
Where are you moving to?
Mexico.
To Mexico. Okay. Thank you.
We'll build tunnels.
Thank you. Now that we're all out of order here, Councilor Barnes.
I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman, but again, so if you have the authority to bring Mr. Parente here from, off stateside, will you also be able to bring his replacement here in case for whoever comes to replace him, will they be brought up to speed? Maybe I should ask the president, the next person coming in, who's going to be available to kind of bring us the information that Councilor Sullivan has been asking for 4 years?
ANEMA will appoint a new operations manager.
Okay, but will that person be able to come, or will that be another 18 months for them to catch up to speed and add things to the book and not bring it?
I am saying that person will come.
Okay.
God, what are we going to do a few months from now? We have new counselors. Start all over again.
Well, since the 24th of August is during my vacation, I may be divorced since we were discussing that, but I'm hoping not to be.
Okay. Very good. Motion was made and seconded. We postpone until the second FinCon, August 24th. It is. All in favor of that? Opposed? And we're going to get information prior to, as it's been discussed. We appreciate you being here tremendously this evening. I think you understood our frustration, and we were able to vent to you, but it was good to see you here, and let me just indicate to you that the doors to our council chambers are always open because all our meetings are public, and when you're invited, we do ask that you attend, because I think it's most important for not only us, but for the people we represent as well. So appreciate that very much for you all being here.
Councilors, next Monday is full council, next Monday, 27th, right here at 8 o'clock p.m. Any other matters? Councilor Sullivan.
Chairman, moment of personal privilege. I just wanted to inform the council, and I'd like any of my colleagues to sign on. I'm going to file a resolve in light of the budget cuts, the bonding cut from the governor relative to the Downtown Collaborative. As you know, this body did convey over for $1 via quitclaim deed the Ganley Building, which is at the heart linchpin of the city's downtown area. So that building is now owned by the state, with the College Collaborative funding being cut from Governor Baker. So I do want to file a resolve to bring the parties from the state before us and find out what steps we need to do to have the state convey that back to the city of Brockton. I look forward to anybody signing on. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you, Council. Any other business to come before this council this evening? See you none. The meeting is adjourned.